I can't hear you for some reason. I could hear the music when you were playing it.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, a little bit. You're very faint.
I wonder, does this thing reset to a lower level? Is that getting better?
Yeah, you're coming up. You're up now.
Okay, I think this thing resets itself somehow or something. Are you familiar with that album that I was playing? Have you came
No,
across that one?
no, it sounds great. I have another one with Charlie Hayden and Kenny Barron, a duo one that's really great as well. So it's
What's interesting about this one to me is they're playing spirituals, but they're not playing it in a gospel manner. The whole album is like that. And I've seen a transcription of that particular one that sounds so simple the way Hank makes it play, but almost every one of those right hand chords that he's playing are huge handed 5-note chords
Yeah,
that's
I
been
know.
executed. And that opening track, I never had never heard it before, Standing in the Need of Prayer. It's not one of the well known ones, but on this album, Danny Boy is on it, and he explains the reason they play it was that they actually say it in the liner notes that they used to sing it with different lyrics in the black churches
All right.
growing up.
Okay.
So I didn't know that until
I
this
didn't know
album.
that too.
So I'll probably play a few from that today. As we, I'm sure we'll be talking about what's going on and in and around. I just saw Nate Lucas, a very good friend of mine, Hammond organ player. He was marching last night, and he had his Facebook Live going while he was doing it, and he was pointing out that the fires being set in New York were not being set by the marchers; they were set by these other guys who were coming in. So it's the same old story all the time. You don't know whether there's a media battle going on to try and win the media reporting by sending in agitators to
Yeah, I mean,
cause them.
you always get that stuff. I mean, it was the same up in the north, there would there whenever you've a group of people, as I say, rioting or whatever, there's always going to be people who are, joining in because it's kind of an opportunity for them, and then other people who are genuinely protesting for whatever reason. So, I mean, it's never, I mean, it's like anything, nothing is, straightforward. Everything is shades of gray of all kinds of things. But I mean, what's not shades of gray with this is the brutality of what happened. I mean, it's shocking, absolutely shocking. And somebody said recently, I thought it was a good point was made, that the only reason that action was taken was not because somebody filmed it, it was because we saw it and that they knew, the people who are responsible for the prosecutions, et cetera, that they knew we'd seen it. But that's the reason action was taken. It's the only reason. And you know, that sounds kind of cynical in some ways. It sounds it, but it's not. I mean, if you look at the history of what's been going on, it's not. There's nothing cynical about it at all. It's actually, you know, it makes absolute sense. You know, I mean, in all the incidents, the girl, you know, the woman with the dog in the park recently, and the jogger, and all of that. I mean, it's just a concentration of things that have been happening for forever. And
Literally forever.
yeah, forever, literally. I mean, and of course, that kind of brutality and all that's kind of the extreme edge of the racism, you know, the violence against, you know, people of color. But the systemic stuff, you know, the everyday stuff, that's the stuff that's very hard for people like you and I, and especially Europeans, I think, because we don't actually live there, but on white people in general, that it's very hard for us to understand the depth of the institutionalized racism that goes on, the day-to-day stuff that you know, people of color have to deal with. You know, that from every facet of life, education, housing, health, you know, it's like it's just systemic. It's completely systemic. And I read a thing on Facebook during the week, and it kind of makes sense, and it's also shocking. It was written from a point of view of a man. He's a black man, American, and he says when he goes for a walk through his neighborhood, he takes his 8-year-old daughter and his dog with him for protection. Because he's not a threat because he's got an 8-year-old and a small dog. But he said, if I'm a 6-foot-2 black man walking through this neighborhood with a mask, he said, I'd be terrified to go out. You know, it that really brings it home to you, you know, that you have to go out with your small child in order to feel safe yourself, because then you don't look like a threat to anybody. But why he should be a threat just by being a black man, that tells you everything that you need to know. But about the sheer everyday shit you know, people of color in the United States have to deal with. I mean, it's not the only place that has racism, and there's systemic racism probably everywhere in some degree, but I think in the States it's particularly bad. And what we're seeing is not just a response to the brutality of what happened last week, but also just a, you know, just enough. It was just like, for the people involved, people of who are living with this every day, it's just gets to a point where you just can't take it anymore. You know, you just can't. And who can blame them? You know, I remember Greg Osby saying to me years ago, he said, it's very hard for a white person to understand what it is to be black in the United States. He said, for start, he said, you probably haven't been followed around in shops every time you go in to look at some clothes. And I remember being kind of shocked by that state, the simplicity of that statement. You know what I mean? You know, it wasn't like, you know, we're always looking at the, you know, movies about, you know, the real extremes, the stuff on the plantations or lynchings, you know, which is what last week's thing virtually was. But you know, the real extreme stuff. But what we kind of, you know, we kind of get that in a way. But what we don't get, or what we don't really have a grasp of, and it's just the everyday, how wearing it must be, you know, all the time to deal with this every day of your life. And of course, the, you know, the danger for young males or males of any age, just by virtue of their skin color, is a horrifying thing to have to deal with in 2020.
And even, you know, like that situation of walking into a store and being followed around, there's so many, which is what you were saying anyway, there's so many different ways that people would never think of that it manifests itself. One very good friend, one of my closest friends, period, and you know him, you worked, I won't say his name because I'm not sure how public this story, this part of the story is meant to be, but went to a largely white school because he was considered a gifted student. He got some sort of scholarship. This would have been at the high school phase, and saw that there was a class in composition available, and went and asked the guy teaching it, could I do that? I'd like to write music. And the guy said to him, what's a tetrachord? And he didn't know. I don't know if I knew what a tetrachord was when I was 14 either. And he
Yeah,
goes,
I
okay,
definitely didn't.
yeah, he goes, you
Definitely
need to do music appreciation. And just kind of brush them aside. Fortunately, in this particular case, this gentleman in question became one of undoubtedly the world's finest on his instrument, but that still hurts. And
Yeah,
he asked
Ron.
me, because of the way I talk music with him, would I be his, the words, his harmony coach. And I think he liked the fact that I had a different approach, as do you, because of the whatever they call us,
Yes,
autodidacts or the learns
that
that
makes it
we.
sound, because it sounds a vaguely Greek philosopher, so that's fine by me.
It
That'd be.
puts a nice title on the fact that we come at things from so many different angles, I suppose. And
Yeah, and I think the point you're making about it still hurts. If you read Ron Carter's autobiography, now Ron Carter is a guy who's the most recorded bass player in history, right? He's been on more records than anybody. He's played some of the greatest music of the 20th century. He's respected and loved. He's a successful man and all of that stuff. And if you read his autobiography, there's a thing where he was playing, and he was studying at Eastman, I think it's very, studying classical double bass. And I'm trying to think, one of the famous conductors, what was his name? I think he might have had something to do with the conducting in Fantasia. What was his name? He was,
Ormandy, was
no,
it?
not him. It'll come back to me. He was like a really famous guy, a white conductor. Anyway, he came up and he conducted the orchestra. And he said to Ron Carter afterwards, said, "I really enjoyed your playing." And he said, "I would love to have you in my orchestra in Florida." He said, "But my board is not ready to accept a colored member at this point." And that's when, Ron Carter decided, I'm having a hope in classical music. But when you read the book, you can see that, 50 years later, despite all the success, despite all the accolades, despite all the things, that this still really, really is wounding for him to think about this. And so these are guys who, the guy you're talking about and Ron Carter, obviously, these are guys who, despite that shit, went on to become world famous. And even for them, it's galling. How must it be for a person in everyday life who's just a regular guy trying to take care of their business, who are still dealing with that shit every day and are not going to be given accolades, all over the world and all that? It must be even worse. And in some ways, I suppose, guys, the very few people of color who manage to become, wealthy in American society, they may be helped a little bit from that. But then again, there's a story that I read from, what's the drummer's name on Roots, the famous guy? The guy, the Roots that are on the TV show.
Yeah, from Philly. I'm
The
blanking.
drummer, he's the leader of the band. I can't
Yeah.
remember his name. Great drummer. Anyway, he talked about being in his own building and getting into the, and he's wealthy, because he's the director of that show. And he got into the elevator, and there was a girl, a white girl in the elevator, and he got in, and he's got the, the big Afro
Yeah.
hairstyle, whatever. When he stepped in, he said he could see that she was terrified of him, like terrified. And of course, the thinking is, why is a black man in this building? You know what I mean? The inherent racism in that, in the sense that that she was terrified because she couldn't. But it's probably a quite an expensive apartment block. And so he said to her, "What floor?" And she wouldn't. She didn't say anything. And he suddenly realized that she didn't want him to say what floor because she'd be worried that he'd follow her out. So then he started thinking, I have to get out of this elevator. I have to get out of this elevator, because if I'm getting out of the same floor as her by some chance, she's probably going to call the cops. The cops are not going to ask questions first. You know what I mean? So this is a guy who's on syndicated television, having to get out at the wrong floor of his own building where he lived, because of the fact that a woman, A, assumed that he couldn't possibly live there because he was a black person, and two, the knowledge that all she had to do was to kind of call the cops and he would be in a really dangerous position himself, despite the fact he's just gone home. So that was another kind of shocking, story. Really, really shocking. And
Talking with Fintan the other night, he reminded me of, you remember that period when John Stalker was brought up north to investigate, and how everyone was horrified by the so-called shoot to kill policy that was being accused of in the north. And so what seems to be more recently prevalent, unless it's just we don't know about it because we haven't seen them filmed, is the steps that it gets to this type of arrest. There's Mike. Hello, Mike.
Sorry, I
That
had
there's
something over the camera there for a
no,
while.
no, yeah. Well, that there's
Sorry, I'm a bit late. I was out swimming in Wicklow Harbour.
swimming in the right? This, did the fish catch you, or did you catch them? He can't hear me, can he? It's
I think
it's
a few of them floated over the top for some reason. Oh, David,
Sorry, go on anyway. Yeah.
let's not go into that for
Yeah,
that
so
reason.
we were we're just talking about what's going on at the moment, globally, but it's the lack of the reason I'm mentioning this is I read something today where two different things went out in different towns. One was a school superintendent in a small town saying that they're not going to discuss this in virtual classrooms at the request of some parents who want to handle it themselves at home with their own kids. And because in school they can't gauge the impact talking about it the way they regularly would if it came up in class would be, that they the parents don't feel comfortable with them talking about it, and they're saying we're aware of censorship and all that, but it just, to me, there's no leadership being shown there in something like that. But then the chief of police in a town up in northern New Jersey sent out this note to the residents. I'll just read aspects of it. And this, to me, this type of commitment to the words is, ranks as leadership to me. So it starts off by saying this is the chief's words, to our blah blah community. Far too often, law enforcement personnel remain silent when we should be leaders in holding others in our own profession and ranks accountable. Our perceived lack of moral courage to speak can easily lead the public to believe we are complacent. As chief of the police department, I want you to know that, like you, I watched the video footage of George Floyd being murdered at the hands of law enforcement. It was appalling, unnecessary, inhumane, tragic, and unacceptable. All four officers involved must be held accountable for both their actions and their inactions. Notably, not one officer intervened to protect George Floyd, a complete dereliction of their duties. I commit to you that in our community we are listening and working every day to do better and involve those we serve in helping us become stronger, both as a police department and a community. Some actions we've taken include the following: worked to ensure that our department racially reflects the community and visitors we serve. Since 2015, 11 of 18 new hires have been people of color. Implemented biannual use of force and internal affairs training, and hired consultants to train our command staff in both de-escalation and lawful slash unlawful application behind use of force. And it goes on and on with it. But that, just those two there are, particularly the second one where the de-escalation, that's what I'm not seeing. It's like you're suddenly on the ground with your face to the.
I mean, what that guy has just said, it's not rocket science. You know what I mean? That's what's so shocking about it. You know,
It's
when he's
not, you
talking,
know
it's
what's
just.
further shocking, Ronan, is that we haven't seen over here somebody in the police force willing to step up and say there was a murder carried out here, to put it in writing like that. And the Camden police in New Jersey, who've been working for years, it's a troubled town, very impoverished town down close to Philly. The police there were among the first to march with the people. So that's, it's the first time I'm seeing something like that, because usually there's, they call it the blue wall. I think you can't, you know.
You
So,
just need you need enough of them because there are, I mean, you know, if you look at things, there are moments. I'm not talking about necessarily in in what's going on right now, but in other historical situations, there are moments where things just turn. And the classic one that I'm sure you will remember, and people of our generation usually remember, is the moment when Ceausescu in Romania went down, where he was addressing the people from the balcony. Now, this is a brutally repressive regime, and he starts repressing, and the people started to boo him, which just an hour before would have been unthinkable. Something snapped in those people. And at that moment, he was seen to be what he was, which is basically, I don't mean as a brutal monster, but which he was, but of that, actually, if the people wanted it, he was gone, and he was gone. That was the beginning of the end. It was a moment. You can see it on YouTube, you can see it anywhere. The look on his face when the people start booing him, and there are moments like that, where the army side with the people, or there's been, or the actual, let's say, the people with the weapons are going to win the war in a way. You know what I mean? Like, this is why, a military coup is always the thing that topples presidents, because it doesn't matter how powerful a president is, if the guys with the guns say to you, "You're gone," you are definitely gone. So,
Especially if you don't have them yet.
yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, I mean, if you see a situation where enough police in the United States start to do this kind of stuff, say, "We're not going to put up with this. We're not going to support it. We're not going to encourage it. We're not going to support it. We're not going to turn a blind eye to it." If there is that tipping point, maybe now is the time. Maybe. I mean, been lots of false dawns before, but maybe now is a tipping point where maybe there will be genuine change. I mean, that's the only thing you can hope for out of something like this, because everything else is so ugly. It's
Yeah,
so.
we wonder through recent history. You see all the school shootings, and you're wondering, will this be the one that'll,
I know, I know.
and straight away, it's even become almost a routine over here that people say we don't want to hear the words thoughts and prayers coming from you
No,
if you've
not.
donated
Yeah.
$1 million to the
No,
NRA or,
I know. Actually, there's a, you know, Chris Rock, the comedian.
yeah.
He saw a very funny thing for us. Funny, but true. He said, "I don't hear this thing about the cops. Well, they're all mostly good, but there's a couple of bad apples in there." He said, "Cops can't have bad apples." He said, "It's like pilots." He said, "You can't have, like, well, most of our pilots are pretty good. There's a couple of them now flying into a mountain. There's always a couple of those guys." He said, "If pilots can only be good guys, you can't have a bad guy pilot, right? You just can't, right?" He said, "Then it should be the same for the cops." And it's funny, but it's also a great point, that there are no, I mean, occasionally one guy goes nuts, but other than that, they are so vetted, and they are so, they're so kind of scrutinized as to their psychology, their behavior, their physical, everything, because they're in command of the lives of thousands of people every week, right? So they're so that and so are police. Police are in command of thousands of lives every week, so they have guns, and most people they're dealing with don't. So you can't have a bad guy, bad guys, like crazy guys like this guy, and who's clearly not a good guy. And I mean, I don't mean for what he did, but clearly someone who would do that is not someone who it's totally out of character. I think if you, I would be very surprised that if you went back into his past, you didn't see, similar violence or bad shit going on. So,
So Cassandra has typed in, welcome Cassandra. I'm half expected you might jump in with us at some
sure.
point, and because especially if it's going to involve a lot of typing for you, but you're welcome as you know. And I think Stephen Keogh is going to join a little later with Xavier Davis, the pianist, who I have never met, but he's going to join in around 5 o'clock, I think. So he said the Second Amendment of the United States Constitution reads a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. There, my take, I don't know what angle you're coming from with it, but words that were written years ago before the type of arms that people had available to them, like, I think the implication there is to defend things that are morally and, civilly, what would you say, the rights of every human being. But a group of people focus in on that amendment as being, if they have the money, they could have a fully loaded nuclear tank in their backyard. Where's the line drawn? And that's the
But
problem.
also, that doesn't stand up to any scrutiny. I mean, all those guys who wrote those, I'm pretty sure all of them who wrote that constitution were slave owners, right? So if because they wrote that, therefore, it can't be changed because it's those guys writing it and it's the constitution, does that mean that it's still okay to have slaves? Of course it doesn't. So how can you have one thing where the morale and the morality and the of 250 years ago, whatever, 300, 250 years ago, is should be exactly the same on that one point, but can be changed on other points. It just doesn't stand up to any kind of scrutiny, that idea. That because it was written down by those guys, it can't be changed. But well, in that case, surely it's okay for everyone to keep slaves then, because they all kept slaves. So how can it be not okay for them to have slaves now, but it's still okay for people to have guns because they wrote it down? There's no kind of, it doesn't stand up to any kind of logical scrutiny whatsoever, that thing.
So, John Donegan just said Ireland changed its constitution, so why can't America? Well, actually, it took, we did, like they amended. There's a, use the same, she's saying, bring me in, coach. Same codes as last week, if you still have them, they'll work. So, it took, in order to change, we had to have a national referendum, right? And
Yeah, that's any constitutional change has to have a referendum. Yeah.
I don't know if there's any kind of hidden things in there that you have to win by a certain majority, or if it's
No, it's a
literally.
simple majority.
Well, that's good in Ireland, because I
Yeah.
think wasn't that part of the problem for Scotland, that they, in order to get a free Scotland, they had to
Yeah.
win by, not by a percentage of the population, not the electorate, you
Oh
know.
yeah, yeah.
And
No.
I, if I'm not getting that all skewed, but we will obviously be talking about this, and we'll come back to it probably. I think Cassandra is probably signing in shortly, and it's a topic that the more opinions we have and things to talk about, the better. I want to, Mike, what are you up to in the last week? Just
Me.
to chime in with you for a minute.
Yeah, but what have I been doing except going to the beach every day?
You're
Well,
going for
you're
a
one of
swim,
those
which is
guys.
a.
No social distancing. Is that you? It's you guys
No,
writing.
the seals were at least 5 meters away.
Okay.
Here comes
Yeah.
Cassandra.
So, but there's no, actually, it's on the Wicklow beach there. There's actually not many people on it, would
Yeah.
you believe?
That you, it's you guys
No,
writing.
the seals were at least 5 meters away.
Okay. We're getting something strange.
I think we're hearing ourselves back through Cassandra's audio features. She's figuring it out there, I think, as she comes in. Hello there.
Hey, Cassandra. Here we are
Hello,
again.
yeah. Hello, my Eichmann.
Iceman, there's a, the Iceman cometh.
Yeah, again.
There's a, there's, so I suppose we should ask you.
Let's talk about guns. Okay.
You want to talk about guns? Okay.
Yeah, I do. Because I have guns. And I was raised in a culture where people
I'm never playing the wrong card behind her again. Just.
Famous last words, Dave.
There's more to that. Sorry, I'm going to interrupt you, Cassandra, with that. There's a, there was, I live in the moment when I play songs, and I remember playing a very well-known song with Cassandra, and suddenly going to another key on the bridge. And to her credit, now, she didn't pull out any guns. She went with me and sang over that key change perfectly. But now, knowing what I know now,
Yeah,
I'll bring a fucking real book with me the next time.
you
Excuse
took your life in your hands. That's true.
So,
I think
guns, I want to hear what you have to say on this.
nobody should have a gun, really. Why not? Well, first, well, if you just look at the point, like there's so many accidents or whatever. Like it was actually a police officer, I think, or she mistook her own apartment for a dental apartment, and he went in and shot the guy that thought it was an intruder. And the guy, that was the end of him. She was in the wrong apartment. So that alone, one life like that, a mistake. If she didn't have a gun, I don't think she was a police officer. If she didn't have a, have the access to a gun, this guy would be still alive. She would have kind of said, instead of having in her head, oh, I can tell you about to shoot him because he's there, instead of saying, well, actually, geez, this is not my apartment. You know, so something like that.
Sorry.
That one slip up. That one slip up for me, I think, you know, it's a human life. I kind of,
yes, let me ask
is
you.
Enough for me to say, you know, you don't need a gun. Maybe a,
would you
a
have
baseball bat would be better.
Would you have Republic of Ireland were it not for a gun?
Sorry, I didn't hear that.
Would you have a Republic of Ireland were it not for a gun?
Open your ears.
I'm on a hotspot on a phone here. So.
Would you not have a Republic of Ireland were not for a gun?
Yes, I know, but I'm talking about civilians.
No,
I'm not talking about the history.
Well, in America, the civilians are the militia. And the reason that that was written into the Constitution is so that you can arm yourselves against enemies, foreign and domestic. Imagine the South in the 60s and the 50s. If Black men did not have access to guns. Just think about that for a second.
I know, yeah. Unfortunately, I'm not fully up on the Constitution and American history. I bore up on jazz guitar playing.
Well, just think about your own history. How do you protect yourselves when the government goes awry?
Yeah.
What happens when you've got a piece of property, you're living off the land, you have your family, and suddenly there's a some sort of insurgency, you know, some sort of rioting, some sort of whatever. How do you protect your family? By praying?
Well, see, I don't have the experience here in Wicklow. You know, well, like we don't have that kind of thing, you know.
Well, there's a reason you don't have it. It's because of the people that died in Ireland for you to have that.
Well, would you agree that there's a gun culture here in this country? There's people worship them. They polish them like they're statues, and you know, they
polish mine. You have to keep them in. You must keep a gun in good working order. But here's the difference, and I think there's a conflation that's happening. You assume that everyone who owns a gun doesn't have training, doesn't understand the seriousness of what a gun represents. You are making that assumption. Most people that own guns or who are members of the NRA have to go through serious training. And if you're born in Mississippi, you have to learn the importance of gun safety. It's interesting that most of the gun violence that you hear about in the media, it's always in places that are not gun cultures. It happens a lot in liberal type areas, you know, where people are unfamiliar with guns. But for the most part in the South, the only time you have a shoot 'em up is in certain places, you know, people get drunk, you know, they're fighting with a girlfriend, you know, pull out a 22, pop them. But it's not as crazy as the media makes out.
Well, you know, prior to the recent with George Floyd, that's front and center the news. Prior to that, it was people taking over their state building, and was it in the Midwest, with guys bearing guns arriving into the Capitol building with guns. Now, as an African American woman, if they were African American men with guns, what do you think would have happened?
Well, I think that some of them were.
Not the photographs I saw. They were in.
Some of them were. I think they had also a similar event in Virginia, if I'm not mistaken. And a lot of the men that were there were Black.
I'd like to see what the racial demographic of that town was to begin with, and what the racial demographic of the police force was before I could comment on that. I just think that a white man walking in with a rifle or whatever it is he's allowed carry and to fully displayed into a public place is going to be treated a lot differently than an African American man.
This is all hype. This is hype. A lot of it is, it's playing on your emotions, and I understand how it affects you, especially. And I'll go into that at a later date. But this is.
When you say you, are you referring to me personally, or just for clarity? Because I know from us playing music together, you're aware of my background. But I just want to make sure for Ronan and Mike's sake, you know, because you can mean plural, you singular.
It taps into your memory, of being oppressed. And so naturally, there's a swelling, a welling of the heart. There's a, you know, there's a sympathy that you have. And it's good. It's good for you to have that. But you have to put things in perspective. Stand back and look at what the media is throwing at you constantly.
I don't watch the news.
I just want to know, why do you, have you ever needed your gun? Have you ever used your gun?
Hell yeah. Well,
there was a few gigs where it got a bit hairy, but she only threatened to shoot us. No.
Yeah, the Irish Art Center. I mean, you know, it happens. No, I never, my gun is placed in a very safe place. And I'm taught that as a child. You never pull out a gun unless you need to use it.
Have you ever been in a situation where you said, maybe I'll go for the gun because of certain thing outside?
Because you knew you had it there.
No.
Not even after a few too many milkshakes, or, you know.
No. The only gun that I reach for is my 22 because I like to eat squirrels.
So did Elvis, I heard. It was in his family cookbook, but
and let me
squirrel pot pie. I'm trying to keep it light for a minute, but can I read out some things that are coming in at us? George Stafford, George, female George, aren't 80% of the guns in the USA owned by 2% of the population? I find that a terrifying vision of the power of a potential militia. Not anti-gun personally. I grew up with them, she said. I think her father's a butcher, actually. So.
No, I don't believe that's an accurate. I don't believe that's an accurate assessment. Oh, somebody's. No, they say
that. Wasn't me.
Well, in Mississippi, everyone has a gun. I can only speak for my state. Every household has either 12 gauge, and most of the men I know have, because in Mississippi, you can, it's open carry. So that means that you can walk around with your gun and your holster.
Can I ask you an honest question there? Because I do understand to a certain extent, and this is something I would have said to you before privately, if you're living in a rural part of the United States in a country where obviously there are people with guns, I can see how if it's in the news that people's houses are being broken into and there's all, and you got strangers coming up scoping out your house, I could see where there might be a certain comfort in having something there that for the security purposes. And I know of some cases of people who are like that. But I suppose it's how this, that Second Amendment that you refer to, has been taken as a blank permission for somebody to be able to buy. Like, I've seen it happen not too far from where I live, only across the state border. And I'm trying to remember the name of the store. People I was with thought that they reacted like they were going to a cultural place like the museum. And it was one of those chain stores that sells guns and hunting paraphernalia. And this was as deep to them as going to the Museum of Modern Art. And I saw guys, but you could buy all these different weapons that I've never seen in my life before, except in movies, and you know, for designed to be used in war. Do you think that do you believe that Second Amendment was meant to cover those type of situations, that I could walk out and buy an automatic submachine gun and enough bullets to blow up to shoot up a shopping mall in one day? That's the question, I suppose, there.
Well, that's two separate issues. The people that are shooting up the shopping malls are usually on some sort of medication, and they're almost always a lone, you know, shooters. The people that go to the
often gun white too, I would say, most of the, yeah.
And you have to ask the question, why is this the same pattern over and over again? And what's behind it?
So if every pharmacy nowadays can, it wasn't the same for years, because I remember there were people that could get painkillers here and then go here and fill the same prescription from, if they went to enough doctors. Nowadays, the cross-referencing going on that's tied to your social security number or your health insurance, they know what medication. I can't even accidentally fill my blood pressure medication a week early or something, because it's already typed in there. If they can communicate with information like that, can't there be something that says, wait a minute, this guy's on this medication and this, and he has a license to own a weapon. We need to go and retrieve that weapon from
him. In most cases, there are regulations that prohibit people who have been treated for any kind of psychological illnesses.
But they most people don't even have to fill out. There's no process, screening process, other than there are some states in the United States where you don't even have to show your driver's license to buy a weapon. You can just walk in and they were selling in county fairs. They were selling weapons out of the backs of cars. A name and a social security number was all you needed.
Where would that be? I've never heard of that.
Arkansas, for one.
I didn't know that.
Maybe. I did.
Yeah, I don't know. In Mississippi,
it's deeply disturbing to me, you know.
Well, there's a waiting period generally. You know, you have to have a waiting period where you check out. When I purchased my gun here, you know, it only took me an hour to get it. But that's because I don't have any, you know, I'm not flagged in any way.
Why did you buy it?
Oh, because I like the Mossberg 500. It's a great 12 gauge. And it's great for long distance shooting. You know, if somebody rolls up, you can point it towards somebody and just go, and that diffuses the situation. It's just the sound of it. That's one of the reasons I got it. It's the sound of it. But it's
and have you done that? Have you used it in that situation?
No.
And would you ever think that you'll ever use it in that situation?
I pray that I will never have to use it.
And so why buy it in the first place? You know, and this is the thing about the gun culture. I think there is a gun culture, and I think people think of it because it's so easy to get. I still think that you don't need it.
Do you know how many people died in the communist revolution?
No, I'm just talking about now generally, you know, among the people. You don't need, I'm talking about, well, in I'm general, talking, people going into a shop, just buying one, you know. Did they check you out who you were?
Well, they did. They did, but they were able to do it within the space of an hour because all of our records are easy to get to. But let's think about Switzerland. In Switzerland, you're required to have a firearm. Did you know that?
I didn't. No. This is where I'm almost hoping that a CNN banner comes up with fact-checking this statistic. We have a lot of people listening in there.
Oh, I thought you said you didn't watch.
I didn't say I've never watched the news. I'm being very honest with you. I haven't been since the pandemic thing. And if you want to know why, I just couldn't stand to hear the head of the operation in where I live lying to us on a daily basis.
They are lying to us. There's a lot of lying that's going on. But and also Israel.
You've been reading How to Win Friends and Influence People again.
Well, I'm just saying, you know, Switzerland, you're required as a citizen to have a firearm.
I'm not sure that's true. I've spent the last 15 years in Switzerland for weeks, and I know that everybody has to do the army, and so a lot of people do have guns because they've had them since they went to the army. But you need a special license unless you're a hunter to keep a gun. And it's kind of similar to here in a lot of ways, you know. And we, you know, you made the point about the bloodshed involved in the independence. That my grandfather was heavily involved in that. He was the 1916 Rising, and he was one of Michael Collins' 12 apostles. And he was involved. He was literally involved in a very famous assassination. He was, you know, literally one of the four guys who assassinated a guy. So my family go back to, you know, to the history of Ireland where the gun was brought into it. And that then evolved into the Civil War where people murdered each other, brothers murdered each other and all this stuff. And he always regretted in later life the violence that he was involved with in his earlier life. And then from the 1960s onwards, late 1960s onwards, this country was involved in 30 years of appalling bloodshed at, you know, the hands of gunmen. And they were the IRA principally, but also some loyalist ones. The IRA were buying guns from Colonel Gaddafi, at least three shiploads of explosives and firearms came from Gaddafi. Nearly 4,000 people died of, you know, being killed one way or the other. If you translate that to the United States, you know, compared to our population, we like having quarter of a million people killed, be something like that. Now we don't have the guns. I mean, it's very difficult to get a gun. You can't get a legally held firearm in this country. It's mostly farmers and hunters who have them. You can get them, but it's very difficult to do that. And I'm very happy about that. I'm delighted we don't all have guns. And I don't think we need them, we need them in order for us to keep our government in line. I really don't feel we need that, or we need it for protection from anything like that. Our republic was born via violent conflict. That's true. But once we became a mature democracy, we didn't need them anymore. So we don't have them. No. There are people who have them. There are still renegade factions of the IRA who exist. And there are drug gangs, criminals who are armed to the gills. But apart from that, the population doesn't have them, despite the fact that in the early days of the conflict, or nothing, you know, but in the early days of the War of Independence, a lot of people had guns, loads of people had them, and they used them. And but now we don't. And I think that's a good thing for me. I'm very happy not to live in a country where everybody feels that they're better off to have a gun. And despite the fact that I'm also part of a country that was born out of a situation in which a lot of people did have guns and did feel they had the need to have guns. But now we're part of a democracy that feels that we don't need to be armed to the teeth in order to make our points or to protect ourselves from people who have a different viewpoint to us.
Well, before I start babbling on, do you want to respond to that, Cassandra? Because I'm going to start I'm going to come in with something, but I don't want to stop you from talking.
I just wanted to ask a question. Do the Garda still carry guns?
Very few of them. They have an armed unit, and but 90% of the Garda, they have no guns. It's like the English police, very similar.
But there are people who have guns.
You mean civilians?
No, I mean in the Garda.
Yeah, they have an armed response unit that deals with violent crime.
Then my question to you would be, why is it okay for them to have guns?
Because there are, in any society, you will get a small group of people who involve themselves in violent crime, but not to the extent where everybody needs to protect themselves from everybody else. It's a minority thing. It's a small thing.
Here's the logic that we have. And because the United States is a large country, it's 20, 40 times the size of Ireland. And the police force can't cover all of that ground. The logic behind having a gun is, if you call the police and it takes them 20 minutes to get to you, would you like to see your wife and children slaughtered?
I think the chances of my wife and children being slaughtered is almost nil.
That's you.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. For me, that's it. The question of if you think about the fact that what you're saying in a way is that in the United States, the chances of your wife and children being slaughtered is much higher than anywhere else. And you kind of have to ask yourself the question as to why that is, if that's what you're saying.
Well, it's the culture. It's the American, it's the culture that allows for people to defend themselves, but it also is open to the opportunity for raiders or drug lords or criminals or, you know, other kinds of people, miscreants, to disturb the peace. So if you're depending on the police force to always protect you from these types of energies that actually do exist, and it's a part of our reality here, then it's foolish to think that you're always going to come out on the right end of it. I'm finished with that.
Because I know what we have is just so people outside, there's a kind of a delay that happens when we do something like this, and we're all friends, so if it appears we're talking over one another, we probably are, but it's all in.
I'm going to go get a little bit of moonshine.
Well, I'm going to need you here for just this, and then you can celebrate the profundity of what comes out of my mouth with moonshine. Now, I'm being somewhat tongue in cheek, but I think there's a few different things that affect decisions that are made in this country. One is they're married to hundreds of years ago. They haven't evolved beyond in the way that we in Ireland have had to. Now, we haven't fully evolved, as you can see. There's still drug problems with guns over there. But for the most part, it's not like there's a very strong chance that my uncle was in some of those squads with Ronan's grandfather, actually, because we've talked about this. So we go back to the similar shared violent history in the name of winning freedom. My uncle was certainly involved in the attempt to break out Kevin Barry, and that was being orchestrated by Michael Collins, and your grandfather would have been probably, you know, in the middle of all that. So I'm coming from the same basis, but my decisions and how I regard people, let's say from England, are not based upon those times when we were trying to fight for our freedom from them. But In the United States, it seems to me a couple of things. Number one, you have a two-party system. You're either Democrat or Republican. There'll never be a situation where a government hasn't got enough to form a majority, so they have to negotiate with other independent or smaller political parties who end up taking care of a certain section. So there's that, and there's the part that I say going back to hundreds of years ago, an African-American person is not allowed to express frustration over racism, sorry, not racism, slavery, without being accused of. Nobody, most white people hear it during Black History Month, most children in school, and it's glossed over. It's presented in a way that's... Let's focus on the heroes, Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King. But they don't. I don't think my kids would have heard much about lynching if it wasn't for us in the house telling them. So therefore, you're not allowed to talk about something that began happening from the time slavery began through to the present. You're accused of being angry. When I'm saying you, I mean whoever would talk about it. One is not allowed to, right? I hate saying one is not allowed. You know, I start to sound like a British politician. But you know what I'm talking about. So therefore, all decisions that are being made in this country are based upon we better not piss off this demographic here because we're coming up to the election. Time to start showing up in black churches to cement the vote. There's don't say anything, be careful about saying anything against the NRA. Don't, you know, they start lining up all these things that are all based upon hundreds of years ago, stuff that was never addressed properly then. Mm. Nobody has the balls to stand up and say, yes, we do have a right to bear arms, but maybe we need to tweak the type of arms that we're allowed on, and maybe we should find some way that if a guy is on medication and we know somewhere along the way he bought these weapons, that we can go to his house and retrieve them. So that's my
I just want to say one thing. I've actually been doing some research on the origins of racism, and I found some very interesting articles about early America, because there was no such thing as racism in early America. The notion of race is a construct. So if I think as long as we continue to look at each other as white and black, you create a polarity that doesn't really exist, especially in America. One of the things African Americans need to come to grips with is, if you are hating white people, quote unquote white people, then you are hating something that's in your DNA. We've talked about this, Dave, which is, you know, really the beginning of my working with my Irish ancestry, is because I had to address them, those ancestors, in order to move past a certain pain. The whole notion of white and black is archaic. And if we're still using those terms, we're still living inside of a construct that was created by, wait for it, 18th century Englishmen, who prior to using black people, used the Irish, referred to them as savages. There was an Irish race. So if you're an African-American, you're dealing with issues that are so deep on so many levels that you have to come to terms with what is it really about? Is it about race or is it about mind control?
I think all of these things are definitely, I have no argument with any of that. I'm going to bring on just a couple. Do you want to get your moonshine? Well,
with any chance of seeing your gun when you get the moonshine, bring the gun in as well. Have a look at it.
Would you like to look at it? Really? Yeah. I'll get
I don't know. Do you really want to do that?
Oh, that's right. This is going to be on.
Yeah, I don't think that's a good idea.
Hello, Xavier. You're walking into a cauldron here, but a good cauldron.
I want you to shoot it out the window, up in the air.
Right, don't pay no attention to him.
Don't test her.
I'll show you my 22.
Make sure I can hear everybody. Oh, I need to unmute people. Sorry. Xavier, sorry, let me say hi again.
It's great to be here.
Sounds
like it's getting interesting.
Yeah,
it is. It's I didn't expect it to go there though, where they're asking to see the gun. Where's Connor when we need him?
I see.
No, but we would have started out the conversation, obviously, talking about all things related to what's happening right now and with the murder of George Floyd and the way I'm seeing some different things in the reactions that I've never seen before. And I was maybe I'm being what they call the cockeyed optimist, hoping that this is the change that or one of the periods of change that we go through as a culture. That I've been waiting on a lot of change to happen for some time. And wishing I knew how to make it happen myself, but starting to invest optimism that out of this tragedy, there are people who are saying enough. Oh God, Cassandra, Jesus, do you really? look at his weapon. He's got a microtonal instrument.
That's much more lethal.
Do you know what? I know we might be on Zoom in the virtual. Right now, I'm looking at the virtual equivalent of people running out of the room.
This is only for animals. You know, it's a hunting. It's for hunting.
Oh, is it? Oh, yeah.
Okay. You couldn't hurt anybody with it.
Oh, you could.
Well, you could if you got close enough and you pointed in the right direction, but you would never do that.
I've hurt an awful lot of people with this.
That's true.
I've been meaning to talk to you about that, Mike. Is that the one with the extra frets? So, Xavier and Stephen, save us from ourselves here. Is it tomorrow, Xavier, you're performing the recital for Global Music?
Well, that was the original plan. But actually, we discovered there's a music industry blackout that is going on tomorrow. And so we just learned about this. And we did a little research and... So I think we decided to postpone it. So we'll do it on June 24th now.
Instead. June 24th. Okay. Can you tell me, I looked up briefly. I didn't, because Stephen mentioned that to me earlier, asked me if I knew about it. I certainly want to show my solidarity to anything that's like that, that's going on. Is that something that, I should consider shutting this thing down tomorrow for? Is it, I'm not asking you to be my conscience, but it's just, if you could explain how it's,
I mean, I think we're trying to understand too. I did a bit of research. I know Stephen did. And it looks for me, I don't have all of the details because I'm not organizing it. But if there's something that, people are trying to organize to promote some change, positive change in this country and around the world, I don't want to get in the way of that. I saw it in some major media, so it seems at least large enough that it's not just a couple people's idea. And I think everyone has to make their own opinion about or decision about how they're going to deal with it. But that's how we decided to go forward.
Yeah, I think now if I was doing a musical performance tomorrow, I would have absolute clarity on whether I would have cancelled too, actually. But help me out here, people. Should I go on the air tomorrow with?
I don't think you're not doing a performance, so I don't think it really affects you.
You don't think this is, no, sorry.
I don't think it's the same for you. In fact, you could have people on your show to talk about things, couldn't you? Like we're doing now.
Could, yeah. That's certainly if it's contributing in some way. Well, kudos to you, Xavier, for doing something like that. And we certainly, June 24th, we look forward to hearing what you play, because I don't know if Stephen told you that I wouldn't remember the name of the album off the top of my head, but I have one of your albums from many years ago, from the 90s, I think.
Oh, okay. That's probably my first one.
It probably is your first one. It was around the time would have been playing upstairs at Jazz Standard in its previous incarnation. And that's when I first heard your name. And
okay.
And heard it many times since then. You're always spoken of.
Dave, you just made me feel incredibly old. So I have one of your answers many years ago. It must be from the 90s. I'm like, oh, geez.
I know. I better choose my words a bit more carefully. You know, it was from a few days back.
Fairly recently in the 90s, they could say that. That sounds, makes me feel better.
So just for people who are, because I think this is very interesting, to where we're all talking from, I'll just catch people up who are chiming in right now. There's from Dublin, Ronan Guilfoyle, that's where Ronan's coming to us. Mike Nielsen is coming to us from Wicklow. Xavier, where are you coming to us from?
East Lansing, Michigan.
Oh, wow, okay, East Lansing, Michigan. And Stephen is coming to us from Valencia in Spain. And Cassandra is coming to us from, I'm assuming, Woodstock, Cassandra. So Woodstock is famous for the festival that didn't take place in Woodstock, right? It actually took place in, what's the name of the... The real location, some guy's farm.
Yasker. Yasker, was it? Yasker.
In Bellel, I can't remember.
I forget too. It gets hard at this time of the day to remember stuff like this. So if anybody has any questions, because this is definitely this is when you start to feel like you're hosting a talk show when there's firearms being produced. I'm really glad that we're not in the same studio. I would have, if this was the Rockefeller Center building, I'd be sending down for security. To go, it's making Jerry Springer seem like a pacifist show.
It's no joke over here in the States.
No.
Did you ever have a BB gun when you were growing up?
Me? No, I was I didn't know.
Did you have a BB gun?
Me?
Yes.
I didn't have a BB gun, but my grandfather did. So whenever I would visit, he was a hunter. So we visit him in Virginia, and I would play with the BB gun. But that's I never actually touched a real gun. I've touched one.
This is equivalent to a BB gun.
Okay.
Okay, so that would be like pellet guns, what is what we would call pellet guns?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I'm very disappointed. I thought you were going to show something much better than a BB gun, Cassandra.
No, I'm not going to do that on. not going to happen. Yeah.
So, which of the guns would you produce if I continue to go into the wrong key on the bridge on God Bless the Child?
Probably
talking about something that actually happened, by the way, live on the air.
No, it was really, I thought it was beautiful.
Well, somebody said to me, I really loved your arrangement. And that's when I said, all right, I got to come clean.
When it happened, it was, sometimes I like for musicians to make mistakes, because it forces.
I'm glad you felt that way.
It forces me to to come to the rescue of myself, to rescue myself. And that's a good, getting back to the gun, that's a good characteristic to nurture in yourself is.
Well, the only part I was proud of in that was how I modulated back to the original key.
You did. And it was beautiful.
I had to come up with a cycle that got us back there. Anyway, it was an in-joke with us for a while because I think it was the third time you think I would have thought about the tune when I was going, suddenly he's going, oh, shit, where does the bridge go on this again?
I have the distinction of apparently physically hurting Benny Golson by playing a wrong bass note. And I remember Clifford on a gig we did together.
Did you?
One of the worst moments of my life. We were playing, you know, of course, you know, with Benny, every tune is, you know, you kind of going, holy shit, he wrote this one too. And we were playing I Remember Clifford one night. We were on a tour and I just lost concentration for a second. I hit the worst.
Clam, as they call it here.
Absolute clam. This is more a bigger clam than you'd see in a seafood restaurant, and it was hideous. And he was playing the solo, right? He's playing the solo, and I hit this note, and he took the saxophone out of his mouth, and he went, oh, like, he got a pain in his stomach. And then he put the saxophone back in and continued playing. One of the worst moments of my musical life. I physically hurt Benny Golson. I remember Clifford.
This discussion actually reminds me of the only record I did with Betty Carter. It was her last record, and we just recorded a tune. And during that take, I got lost somewhere. Like I missed the bridge or something. I can't remember exactly what happened. But we were listening back in the booth to the take, and I knew it was coming. And then it came up, and I was like, yeah, Betty, I got lost there. She's like, that's the one that's going on the record. And that's on there.
Oh, no.
She liked that energy as well. And I appreciate it, too, because it takes me, you know, you get in your comfort zone, and then these moments wake you back up, and you're like, you have to find a path back. And the path back can be very interesting often. And so
exciting.
It's scary, but it can be exciting.
Yeah.
Yeah, Benny never mentioned it after the gig. I was waiting for him to say something. He never mentioned it, you know, but he didn't have to, I think, after that. After groaning physically on stage, you know, I think you get the message pretty well.
I'm asking this question of Cassandra with first of all, having played a two-leg tour and then some other collaborations along the way with her. I never heard her do anything like this, so I'm curious. Have you ever have an intro play to a song that you know what song you're supposed to be singing, and your mind just goes blank, and how'd you get out of that?
I remember it was Wichita Lineman and Kevin Bright was playing the guitar intro to it, which is so beautiful. I mean, it's just perfect. And for some reason, I heard another note, and it was the worst, like you say, a clam, you know?
Yes.
It was like, what did I, the only way you can get out of it is realize that you're only half a step away, as Miles Davis always says. You're only a half a step away from making it work. And that's what got me through was, you know, knowing that, okay, all you have to do is slide down, get situated, and you're going to be all right. And I was okay.
Mike Nielsen, now, the half step thing wouldn't work with him because he has a microtonal guitar that has 12 steps between a half step. That's not the one you have there, Mike, is it?
No, it's over here somewhere, yeah.
Can I see your guitar?
Yeah, where the hell is it? Hold on.
Mike's in the 12-step program of playing the right note.
I'm definitely not.
Just one thing, I never get lost.
This is it, is it?
Let's talk later, Mike.
Hold on, I have to cut out Stephen. Sorry, you're on the end because I can only see you. How are you, Stephen? I haven't seen you for ages.
Been a long time.
Wow.
Look at all those frets, mini frets. God, you can't get your fingers between some of those, can you?
Oh, you can. Otherwise, they wouldn't be there, yeah.
That's true.
Is it true? Well, here we go, listen. It's dark here, so you get a chord like this, or something like that. Can you hear that?
I love it.
I knew you'd like that, Cassandra. I knew.
Oh man, is that? Did you build it or?
I designed the thing. It's based on the structure of the guitar where I reverse the fretboard template and add in the frets. So it's like a tempered system from the other side as well.
So what kind of temperament is it?
it's a mixture. It's a mixture of various different things. There's 16 cents and, 40 cents and 80 cents and that type of thing. So it's a various different mixture of intervals. So it's not just quarter tones or anything. That's various different things. Yeah, it starts off with a Pythagorean third. No, Pythagorean comma.
Pythagorean.
Yeah.
Pythagorean. Okay.
I love his early stuff.
the acoustic years.
Yeah.
Do you know? Full disclosure. I have a photograph of this somewhere too. I was walking down. About 8 years ago, closer to the beach, and I saw this electrical van, and it said Mahler Electrical, and I couldn't resist. I took a photograph of it, and I just said, Mahler called Bob Dylan, and Bob said, don't worry about it, Gustav. They said, they're going to hate you at first, but after about 10 years, they're going to embrace your acoustic stuff as well as your electric stuff. But... anyway, I have that somewhere on my Facebook page that I remember it elicited a lot of funny comments from musicians who were relating to similar things. So let's see. Mike spends so much time playing outside, he has permanent exposure, according to Sean McLaughlin. John Donegan says, well done, Betty, and great that you are all so honest about these incidents. There's a Stephen hasn't told us one of his clams yet, so
you're up next, Stephen. Brutal.
Give us one from the orchestra. Have you ever? You were playing the bass drum. Have you ever come in with the incredible?
Oh, I have.
In the wrong place, has he? Have you?
Yeah, in the fast movement, in the fourth movement of Tchaikovsky's First Symphony, I think. I played the loudest bass drum note you've ever heard in your life in a general pause.
Did people notice?
I really heard it there. That's why I played it there. It was the biggest upbeat you've ever heard in your life.
Sometimes you have to make your own solos.
And you could hear the audience say, that's Stephen Q! And you became famous.
Yeah, fuck Tchaikovsky, that was Stephen.
There you go.
So what about something that's very percussion heavy, like Benjamin Britten, some of his stuff, or Ravel stuff? Were there any epic clams that you remember, if it wasn't you, that guys would come in with execute beautifully a passage on mallets, but in the wrong place?
Not so much. I do remember one guy, I can't mention any names, but it was a proms season, and we were doing West Side Story, and this guy had come over from another country, and he'd spent all afternoon in the green room, and by the time he got to the stage, he wasn't fit to do anything. The piece started, he got up to play the Tubular Bells, and he lost his footing, he slipped, and he grabbed onto to the frame of the Tubular Bells to try and steady himself, but he fell backwards, and the bells came down on top of him. He had to lie there for the rest of the concert because every time he moved, it was blang, blang, blang. So those kinds of things do happen.
A French friend of mine is a jazz drummer. He's actually the drummer on that big band thing I played last week. Do you remember that? He told me a great story about a friend of his who's a jazz drummer in France, also plays tuned percussion, you know, very well, certainly enough to play like in a pit, you know, and play tuned parts in a pit. But the one day something happened very suddenly and there was a terrible mistake made. So Pierre Boulez's ensemble Intercontemporain, one of their percussionists got food poisoning, like, and they had a rehearsal that day. And somehow there was some incredible mix-up. And they didn't know, somebody recommended this guy. And he had no experience at this level of like ridiculously complex music. And he didn't know who Pierre Boulez and the ensemble of the Contemporary. So he just got this gig, you know. It's like, and it was a lot of money for a jazz guy. So he'd go, oh, that's cool. What, some tune shit? Okay, great. So he goes along to the rehearsal. You can imagine this is like the most incredibly nightmare scenario. It was along to the rehearsal. And all the guys are there from the ensemble and they don't even look at him. They're reading their newspapers and, you know, they're like those kind of, you know, specialist guys, and they don't even look at him. They don't say hello or nothing. So he's there. He's like, so he goes up to the percussion and he opens up the pad and he looks. And it's like, you know, the first thing is like septuplets with the first three silent, right? That's the first thing. And every bar is changing meter. Like, and it's like 3/16, 2/8, 4/2, and it's quintuplets. And he's looking at, he's like, what the fuck? And he's turning the pages and it's getting worse, you know? And he's looking around at the guys and all the guys are just reading the papers and all this stuff. And eventually Boulez comes in, doesn't even say hello to him, nothing, like nothing. Just, you know, tap, and everyone puts down the stuff and they're all used to working with him, of course, and they're playing the hardest music in the world. He's there, he's like, holy shit, you know. And then Boulez starts conducting, and he's conducting 1 meter with one hand and another meter with the other hand. He's got two meters going on. And this guy's scuffling, trying to desperately play anything. And he says, he could see Boulez staring at him. He's just glaring at him. And eventually he stops. He says, stop. Now everybody stops. And he points to him and he goes, percussion. Doesn't even ask him his name, right? So percussion. He said, play me your part. So the guy looked down at the stuff. He's like, it's a whole lot of percussionists. And he picks up a pair of go-go bells and he goes, and walked out of the room.
Oh, man.
What else could he do?
Yeah.
So this is my part.
Wow.
It's one of those.
We haven't listened to a little bit of music from what I played from earlier on, Hank Jones and Charlie Hayden from the Steal Away album.
Yeah.
I was thinking I might play Danny Boy from this because of the reason we mentioned earlier on that it's sung in an awful lot of African American churches with different lyrics. Cassandra, I know you didn't. You've told me before you came up a different route. You weren't into the gospel churches so much growing up, right? You were in a Methodist church. But Xavier, did you come up through the church?
I also didn't grow up in a traditional gospel or Baptist or Pentecostal church.
I can tell.
Yeah, you could tell.
Presbyterian, right?
Huh?
Presbyterian.
Yeah. My dad was a choir director at a Presbyterian church. So that's what it, until I was 13, and then we kind of switched churches. But when I would go to, again, to my grandmother's in Virginia, I would, you know, we'd go to the old country church and, you know, get all of that.
So you'd hear some of these. So would you, just curious, would you both have heard Danny Boy sung with a different, you know, with a hymn set of lyrics to it? Have you what we call Danny Boy now? You would have. Okay, so because I know either Charlie Hayden or Hank Jones mentioned on the liner notes that they explained the reason why this was included. They said it may surprise some people And that's where I found out it had been a hymn. But well, let's take a listen to this as something that joins our cultures, I guess.
Maybe a shot of the gun just before we start.
So here's the thing, Mike. You're going to, you've now caused, Cassandra now is going to have, you know, that Patty Hearst shot that was taken from the overhead walking into to get the bank. There's going to be, you're going to have to, the only way you can defuse this now, Cassandra, is make that an album cover.
Actually, I thought about that.
Did you? There's a, we lost Stephen, I think, did we? There's a,
yeah, he was frozen for a minute, then he disappeared.
Yeah, he's probably refilling the glass and coming back.
Coming back.
There's a, okay, here comes a.
Thank you.
Beautiful, beautiful.
Lovely, yeah.
So, a little trivia question: the beginning, the intro, and the ending. Who knows what it was?
Oh
Where it
yeah.
came from, and it cements the idea of the Irish connection.
So what was it again?
You know it, do you, Mike? Did you? Boom,
Oh, well, I was
boom.
just trying to. I just said that's from somewhere else, and what I can't just think, I can't think of it at the moment.
You want me to tell you?
Yes.
It's the verse to How Are Things in Glacomorra.
The verse to it.
Scottish, though, isn't it?
I don't think so because it, well, maybe it's set is How Are Things in Glacomorra, is that from Brigadoon, is it?
Yeah, it's
I think,
Scottish.
okay, but the guy who wrote it told George Mesterhazy he was trying to write his Danny Boy. That's why I thought it was kind of interesting. I'm wondering if he I wonder if he told the same thing to Hank Jones.
Well, you know, there's a very funny about 5 years ago, Keith Jarrett played in Dublin, and extraordinarily for him, you know, he was very chatty and funny. You know, it was all the opposite of what he's supposed to be, you know, this grumpy guy that you can't cough on. Anyway, he played How Are Things in Glacomorra, and he said he came out and he was introducing all the pieces from the, you know, he's usually has the reputation he doesn't say anything, but he was introducing all the pieces. He was joking, he was laughing also. And he said, you know, seeing as I'm here, he said, I'm going to play a song that will need no introduction. And he played How Are Things in Glacomorra, which of course is Scottish. And when he finished, he stopped and then he looked up at the audience and he said, and he kind of went, he said, oh, he said, that's not Irish at all. Sure, it's not. Oh, God.
It
It was
says
really
here,
funny. It was really.
I heard a bootleg of how
it
many
says
times
here
was he in
that
Dublin? Because I think he played Body da 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 da. Yeah.
it's about an Irish village or something,
Oh my.
a fictional village in Ireland. That's what it's about. So,
Glacomorra.
yeah,
yeah.
I think you're thinking with when he I won't say who sent me a bootleg of that. They were so proud of him playing, and because
Oh,
he played,
maybe you did.
it
Maybe
was
he did
that
that.
one.
Yeah, absolutely. Could have been that one.
I'll tell you what he did play. That was I know you heard it because you're at the show, but everyone else was. He recorded it on his Night Music album for his wife. I guess it was a My Wild Irish Rose. Is his
Yeah.
wife's name Rose or something? And that's so well known in the United States, but not in Ireland, except in the Cayley bands who played it like a waltz. And he's playing it as a beautiful ballad.
He does play. There is a beautiful version of Danny Boy online where he plays it solo piano as an encore, I think from Japan. That's exquisite the way he plays it. I mean, he doesn't really improvise on it at all. He just plays the melody, intro melody, and then out. Gorgeous thing.
Have you ever sung it, Cassandra, Danny Boy? Because I know you've sung other, you've sung the with when we were working together. I remember the what was the
Oh, that's the parting. The
the
parting.
parting glass.
Right.
Yeah, I remember you doing that one and
Yeah, I did it at the when I received the Spirit of Ireland Award, and I had made myself say, I'm not gonna sing that song. But for some reason, I don't know, there was like a energy, a spirit that hit me. And I looked over at Sam Barsh and I said, let's go to Danny Boy. And then I just started singing it. But I had no intention of singing it because I know how much it irritates Irish people. But
After the 15th verse.
it was the whole point of it was to, I guess, in my, I don't know. I guess I was thinking I have to integrate the part of me that knows that song as being a part of our culture. You see, the Irish diaspora is not is not monolithic, you know. And so for us, that song is almost sacred, whereas for you, it's like a throwaway. It's like Leprechauns. For y'all, that's like some corny stuff, right?
No, you know what? In my case, there's a link to me with this, right? That I told you this, I think, Cassandra, did it, that I happened to mention to George Benson one time that there was a concert at the Cork Jazz Festival where three piano players, George Shearing was one of them, and I think Marion McPartland was another, and I forget who the third one was, and they weren't listening to each other's set, and they each said, now we'd like to play something from this country, and or I would like, they were solo piano sets, and apparently by the time whoever was on last, say, oh no, don't play Danny Boy. So I told George that story, and George then announces me in Belfast on what became his live DVD, that he said, my good friend David O'Rourke told me, George, if you go to Ireland, he said, do not play Danny Boy. And then he plays his version of it.
That was a lot of American, when they were American guys, when they were working as, like, in the days when a lot of guys would travel as singles and play with local rhythm sections. They very often used to play Danny Boy, thinking that it would be well received. And it was always introduced pretty much the same way. And now here's a song I think that will need no introduction. And the whole audience like, oh no, not Danny Boy.
Yeah. Now, you know, we've done now, Xavier probably plays a beautiful version of it. If he goes to Ireland, he's going to be afraid to play it.
Never play it now.
You never play that one now.
That's a good move, Xavier. Yeah,
you should play it. But when I was in Boston, I used to play in an Irish band, playing around the Irish clubs, playing bass. And it was like going back in time every time. You know, it was unbelievable. It was like going back to the, you know, 50s or 40s. And they just wanted these kind of camellias all the time. They've never kind of moved on from, you know, it was strange. It was just going back in time when she went into the dance, you know. It was like going into the country dance in the 1940s, you know. So I think that's the kind of,
just for Xavier and Cassandra, the expression camellias, have you heard that before? Have you?
I don't know that one.
It means it's a particular type of song that you feel guaranteed everybody in the room is going to know and sing along with. So if all else is failing, which it usually was for some of those bands, this is what they would fall back on.
You know? Like Danny Boy.
You know,
it's a contraction of come all of you.
Is it?
Yeah, of course. Oh, yeah, come all of you. Come all of you. It's a contraction of that. There's a come all you.
Sounds like a lot of crack.
He's well rehearsed there.
No, that's the only thing I know.
It's a huge advantage to know that they're not talking about the other crack when they're saying they stayed up all night having great crack.
This party's getting a little bit wild. Pull out the crack.
So probably
it's like between like a Newry accent or something, you know.
So your neighbor, our neighboring town, is watching in, Cassandra Paul Duffy.
Hi, Paul.
And gentleman that I had on here the other day from Las Vegas, had a great time with him. Jimmy Mullador just signed in. Hey, Jimmy, how you doing? And Jimmy was the band leader in Las Vegas among many other jobs, but the Las Vegas Hilton were in the last days of Elvis playing. And I just found out the other day he had James Moody was in the band with him. He got Moody. Moody was his hero. And he was Moody's protege. And he sent me something the other day. I wish I'd prepared better for this, but it's Moody singing Moody's Mood to him. And a video of it. It's brilliant. Yeah, Josephine Smith is saying you learn something new every day. Come all of you. I didn't know that either, I must admit. So I should read out who I have coming up this week, just so we know. I kept the week open because I was waiting to schedule somebody, and then that all got sorted out. But tomorrow, somebody from my earliest days, and Richie Buckley, I'm going to be catching up. We had his brother Michael on the other day. So Ronan and I have deep history with Richie, saxophone player who, I'd be surprised if you didn't come across him, Cassandra, because he was with Van Morrison for years. And I know you were, oh, I didn't realize you you disappeared. Go put the gun away before you do.
Oh, listen, ask Paul Duffy how he feels about guns.
There's there you go, Paul. How do you feel about guns? Right, that's asking the question directly. So that's Tuesday. Wednesday, Christine Tobin is coming back, so I can talk to her at greater length about some of the stuff she's done. Thursday, I thought I edited this in. A friend of mine that I haven't been in touch with for a while, great guitar player from Nashville who produces a lot of recordings and also has composed a lot of music for TV and especially like the Netflix shows, are Chuck Schlachter. And one of the things he's contributed music to are, do any of you watch Comedians in Cars Getting Coffee?
Have you seen that
series? And so sometimes you'll hear this, a pocket of kind of maybe piano and bass, just playing a swinging groove with always probably seeming to avoid, what would you call it? Royalty-based music, just something to fill the thing. So he told me he got a few episodes of those. So that's Thursday. And Friday, former world lightweight boxing champion, looking forward to, I'm a big fan, his Ray Boom Boom Mancini from Youngstown, Ohio, is going to be on. And that's all the pre-bookings until the 11th. Flo McSweeney is going to come on. Vocalist Cassandra, you might like to, you know, you tend to check in fairly often, but June 11th, a great singer from Ireland who, she would have come through the, I suppose she's more known for the pop and rock stuff, but she's done an album recently that she's very proud of, and she's singing. They're not just standards, it's some Tom Waits stuff. And so it's somebody who's stepped back into the fray. And that's it. Anybody want to chime in? Oh, here comes Stephen, I think, again. I'd better let him in. My first question would be, how dare him leave the room without our permission?
Well, look, Paul says, I'm packing.
What did he? Yeah. Paul said, I'm packing. Okay. So are you in an open carry scenario, Paul? Type in. What were you saying, Stephen? You had to leave to...
No. I when Ronan said percussion and pointed his finger like that...
Too much bad memories.
You ran for the exit. So anybody want to say anything before? I would like to play another Hank Jones thing and talk about it then, and then maybe close out. But does anyone... I don't want to stop people from talking... Does anyone want to say anything before I shift?
Before you pronounce sentence.
Before I pronounce it. Cassandra has her hand up and Stephen's moving forward.
I was just going to ask, where's the coffee?
The coffee, there's, well, you know, we're doing social distancing right now. You have to be at least six states away and where are you in order to.
Just about the fee again, Dave. That is the
How much did you want to offer me again? Let me know. Yes, Stephen.
Wondering, did we play anything of Xavier's, or what did you do that one?
I didn't, but if you have something that's ready, I was kind of anticipating that we might get Xavier back at another time to talk more music and his music. But
sure,
I was really, but I'd like to play. If you have something ready to go, if you could type it in for me, Stephen.
Oh,
if you're able to find, or Xavier, if you have something, you can type in a YouTube link. via the chat. But I really appreciate all of you coming on today and talking through some of the wide range of subjects that we tend to hit. And
I have a little bit of sound here just before, just see if Cassandra knows. Listen.
That would be
that's outside your window. Get that thing out.
I thought you wanted me to identify it, which I can.
Can you?
Of course. That's how I, you know.
This is all I can find, Dave, right now.
Semi-automatic, of okay. course.
Back, but it may not be the one that Dave.
I could actually send a link of the from the record.
I sent a link, but it's O. Henry. I don't know if you want. I mean, I think
that's fine. Yeah.
Yeah. Do you get that, Dave?
I see. Yes, I see that. So we'll have a listen to that. And one of these days we'll have to play something by Cassandra, so people won't think that she's just somebody who listens to this show every day, right? or not every day. I don't mean to be presumptuous, but many days. This. So let's have a look at this. We're going to have a YouTube ad or something like that first before. Bear with me. Thank you. Beautiful. They're loving that.
Appreciate that.
Wow, you got
that's dangerous.
Oh, that coming from you, that means a lot.
Oh, look, where can I get that?
It's on Detroit Music Factory. It's a it's part of the Mack Avenue family.
Oh, I remember that. Yeah. So you got a few. Let me read out.
It's gorgeous.
Starting with Paul Duffy, said, that's some righteous piano playing.
Ah.
And John Donegan, pianist, who's also put out a few albums recently of his compositions, and he said, "Wow, love the arrangements too. Really great groove." John Daly said, "That's great playing, Xavier." And Josephine Smith is saying, "Please bring Xavier back again." She spelled it with a Z and later corrected herself with a Z for you Irish guys. Right? And John Donegan is asking, "Is that Regina Carter on violin?"
It is.
It is. Okay, good catch, John. So we're getting close to wrap-up time here. I want to thank everyone again who appeared here today. And just a reminder that June 24th, you'll be able to attend one of Xavier's online concerts for the Global Music Foundation. They take a dip on June 11th in the usual quality of artists that they hire. They're really showing, Stephen, I'm surprised you're not getting complaints on this one, that you need to do a bit better with the programming, I have to say.
I understand the occasional error.
Yeah. So if anyone hasn't figured it out, I'll be playing on June 11th for Stephen's organization. And Roland, Mike, have you any online stuff going on at the moment? Have you that I wouldn't have heard about?
No.
Is that have you? I know you're doing. You know, both of you have to preside over a lot of educational related stuff through.
I'm doing. You know, one of those things. Actually, managed to get Tommy Halfordy to make something, which he's going to play. Where myself, him, Connor, myself, and himself are going to, you know, play. I think it's I Hear Rhapsody. You know, so if anybody knows Tommy's phobia for technology. You'll know what a miracle this is that we've managed to get him to do it. And apparently today he appeared on Facebook. I mean,
he friended me today on Facebook.
It's unbelievable. It only took the worst pandemic in 100 years to get Tommy Halfordy online. That's amazing. So I'm working my way through that at the moment, but that's about it at the moment.
So, and Mike, have you got anything?
I'm supposed to be doing something that Ronan and Connor put down.
Yeah, I've forgotten about that. It was weeks ago.
I'm in house move mode, so my amplifiers are in under the. I have to get the amplifiers out, and I've been asked to do something else. Yeah, but it's not really the real thing. It's very hard to do things. You're not really trying to do something.
Mike, if Tommy can do it, you've no choice now.
I don't know.
No excuse.
I have an idea. Yeah, I just have to get around to do it. So before Christmas, I'd say I'll get around to do that.
So, Cassandra, have you been doing online performances? I know you host, you have discussions online. Actually, I meant to ask you, who are the three other ladies and what's their background? Because I've watched a few of them and one of them was actually... I have to be honest, she was revealing such personal, a lot of personal kind of trauma. I wonder, did she know she was online at the time? Because one of the other ladies was saying, you know, we're live. but it was very, you know, very, very moving, to say the least. Who are they?
Well, Rhonda Richmond is, that's the lady you're speaking about. Who was very emotional at the end. She and I were in the junior high marching band together.
Oh, okay.
I played clarinet and she played trombone. She's a lifelong friend. And now she's also a singer-songwriter. And the rest of the ladies are, you know, old friends from college days. So, you know, we just get together and we talk very frankly about, you know, the current events and what's moving us. And tomorrow, is it tomorrow night? Yeah, tomorrow night at 11 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, we are going to have our first live talk. And there's a lot to talk about. You know, there's a lot to air out. And it's important to get our perspective because I don't know if there are very many Black women who are expressing their deepest emotions during this. You know, we're very much affected by a mother's loss of a child and the fact that it's a Black child. You know, it's something that's deeply disturbing for us. So we're gonna be talking about that on Tuesday night, and it's gonna be on the Yellow Scarf Facebook page.
I was trying to remember the name, the Yellow Scarf, the other day, because that's, would that account for, particularly when you're always supportive of artists that are playing or artists you haven't heard of performing music on here that you've made it clear that you like that I will showcase some people that you mightn't have heard, you know, before, but particularly female artists who are singing, an awful lot of them get a great charge out of the supportive comments that you will write to them or chime in. They're so excited. Is that a byproduct of what you were doing in the scarf, the Yellow Scarf? It's only the other day, because my mind keeps churning around, you know, all the time, looking for the connections and if they exist. And it just jumped out at me. That's what you were doing in the. The Yellow Scarf is a venue that you can tell them about, Cassandra, that you opened in Jackson, I think, was it?
Yeah, in Blacktown. And it's a listening room. It's a place where we encourage people to come in who had original material. You know, not the usual thing that you have in Jackson, which is the blues or, you know, people doing covers. So that's what the Yellow Scarf was about. And now that we're closed, we still want to highlight the local talent, you know, young people who have nowhere to go right now. They don't have anywhere to go.
Now, are those premises, are they owned by you? Did you buy the premise? Do you own the real estate?
Hmm? No.
Oh, you don't? Okay. So it's permanently closed then, is it?
Well, it's in my garage in Jackson. I have a home in Jackson, and everything that was in the Yellow Scarf is actually in my garage. So it's still open if when I go back down after the COVID, if you want to come visit it, you can come visit me at my home.
It's not exactly a 5 mile jog down the road, but it's, you know, if they let us out, we'll, how much does it pay? You know, I'm a very mercenary musician now. I don't, I only take my guitar out for major paying gigs, like 50 or higher, $50 or higher. No, I know it's about a showcase, right? That's what it's.
Nobody's making money right now.
There's speak for yourself. I'm beating money away from my door. It's crazy. I must have found $10 outside. No, it's that is true. There's I haven't done that much. I haven't done that much online stuff, but I did. You know, I did that workshop a few weeks back, and I found out after the fact you made a kind, generous donation during the middle of that. When I did, I had issues with my still have with my PayPal. I didn't know until I caught up with my friend Nick, you know, that said, should I be acknowledging? And he's trying to translate the names as to who. So thank you for that. And then Stephen's performances today, you know, the transfer wise that you told me, I ordered the card, you know, that card that, you know, which makes it easier. And you said usually you had yours in 2 days, and So when I ordered, they said usually we deliver them in 2 days, but because of the pandemic that's going on, so I got it today. So, but that's an interesting way. Do any of you use that as a method of transferring money? You know, if you're receiving money from abroad, or have you used that before, or is that mainly known in Europe?
Use what?
Transfer wise,
Oh
it's kind
yeah.
of like an international Venmo, or
Yeah, I've used TransferWise.
you use it. So it's I'm new to it, but yeah. So that's why, you know, Stephen is hosting these concerts that he's trying to remind people that you pay into these things, and their tickets been sold, and they're not hugely expensive. They're $10, ten sorry, $12 US, maybe comes out at 13 with processing charges at the end, but it's 10 euros or $12 approximately, and they get a half hour performance and a Q&A with the artist, and some of them are being very well attended. You know, there's I was kind of shocked at the people that showed up at mine. You know, there's because I'm looking there and go, how did they find out about it? And but it was great to see, and it was as close as I've gotten to doing a live performance that I felt there was an audience there. Because if you set Xavier, when you're performing, if you set it to the gallery view where you see all the faces, it feels like a room full of, if you have a large screen monitor, it'll feel like a room full of, you know, the audience. Yeah.
I watched Jim Riddle yesterday.
I saw you on there. I looked in on
Great.
that one too. It's I saw the performance. That was a good one too.
That's nice.
Is there a link? Can you, Stephen, can you give us a link?
Can you send the link to
I can, but I can put it here. I don't have any way of contacting you, Cassandra, but I can send it to Dave. Should I put it here now?
Oh, whatever's comfortable for you.
I could certainly send you her email address if that's okay with you, Cassandra.
Yeah.
You'll get it. His is a weird email address, gold to black. That's that part of it. There's a
It's because I had two gold cats and a black cat at one stage.
Really?
His cats are special, yeah.
I have two black cats.
Oh, really?
I remember you having one, but I didn't know you had two.
Yeah, I had to get another one because the one was lonely. Male and a female.
So you're the only
You
one that
melted
asked the
all
same
cats.
question. Sorry, have you done any online performances, Cassandra?
You know, just you know, I did something for Easter, and
Oh, I saw that actually,
I'm just working on, I have two separate projects going on with musicians that are, it's long distance. One is an Americana project, and the other is finishing up. The other one is very interesting, actually. There's a project that I'm working on that has to do with Ireland.
Oh, yeah.
And I can't really talk about it because it's so, right now it's just in the beginning, but it's fascinating. There's a wonderful lady that I met who's writing music to the walking up the mountains to the landlords to ask for relief from paying the rent. And it
I
just
wrote that song. I can give you the changes if you like.
You know, I thought about you. I really did. But it's not at a point, and you know, it's very.
Was that a historic thing, Cassandra?
Yes. Yeah. It has to do with the specific region in Connemara.
Yeah.
And it has to do with these people who died along the road, you know, and didn't make it to the landlord's place to get relief. And it just has taken over a lot of my emotional space right now, because all of this is happening at the same time, right? We're going to our landlords and we're saying we can't pay the rent right now. What, you know, give us some relief. So it's very interesting, and I'll talk about it at another date.
Sounds good. To close out, does anyone feel any kind of, in the midst of the turmoil that we're experiencing, is there optimism at all in, you know, knowing that throughout history there has been turmoil and there has been, and, you know, depending how you look at it, we just seem to, sometimes we seem like we're repeating the same mistakes over with differing consequences maybe, and then there are periods in history where we think we've learned from our mistakes and we'll never make those mistakes again. Where does anyone think we're at right now? Give me something to grab onto, you know.
I don't have much faith in humanity at all, but things do change. There's no doubt about that. Outside of anything we do in our folly, big things change, definitely.
Yeah, I personally, I cling to hope. That's what we have. You know, that's the. I think it's easy to be pessimistic when you look, you see things happen. You know, after this happened, you thought it would change, and this, and you know, you go down the line, and but this somehow feels right now. It feels different. There's just so many things converging. And it feels like maybe it's the perfect storm to create something, some sort of change. You know, people have been isolated. Yeah. So many things are converging right now that I think maybe this is the type of change that, good change, hopefully, that would come out of this is something that couldn't have happened a year ago or in a year. You know, this is like the only time that it could happen, and perhaps this is the moment. You know, we may look back on it and you know, that was one of the biggest things that happened in 100 years, or you know, we don't know, but I hope.
Well, you know, if that happens, and we've definitely seen these things when we look at the history books, wouldn't it be a beautiful thing that out of the sadness of the loss for George Floyd's family, that 50 years from now, that people would read about that incident and how it changed everything, and people came together and in a way that hadn't happened before. That's the kind of thing I was looking for right now, to say, I need to walk away. I do pretty good with this kind of stuff because I'm talking on this thing every day with people, so I get to, you know, how can I put it? I get it's a form of therapy for me, hearing what people are working on, how their life took them to this point, musically, and a lot of joyful stuff. So, in a kind of way, it's keeping me from having to deal with. I suppose my biggest challenge would be self-pity, because oh shit, all my gigs are gone and I've nothing to do today, what am I gonna, and then you start thinking about all that kind of stuff, and I haven't gone there at all, but this what happened with George Floyd, and
well, it's not just him, is it? It's thousands of others.
No, but he definitely, we have a video of a certain kind of camera angle on that, just to be clear, I watched the whole thing because I read where somebody had said to click off and not watch that is an example of the kind of privilege that they call, I know it's not only white people would click off it, that can't, some people can't watch a man lose his life. But something told me I needed to honor this man's life by watching the whole process. And at no point did I hear any anger as he was losing his last breath. It was a gentle plea on each occasion to allow him to breathe. And then the other people watching that were saying, there's one guy who says, yo, bro, that's a jiu-jitsu move you're doing. You know what you're doing. You know that moment in the, assuming that you, that you'd watched it. That so this guy can't say that he didn't have any warnings. And I think what's different about this particular one was we see that officer looking up at the camera with his hands in his pocket going, I know you can see me. I know you can see everything I'm doing, but I'm going to get away with this. You know, there's that. That's the kind of thing I think that got to a lot of people. That's been different. We either haven't seen it or we've been shielded from it up to now. So I don't mean to. What is the name of the young lady that died in custody that last year? Does anyone remember the young African American lady that
died where?
She died in police custody. I'm just blanking. I'm blanking on the name. You know,
there's like so it's, yeah. I
think that we're focusing on the racial issue because that's what we're supposed to focus on. But trust me, it's not just about Black people being murdered. They're coming for all of us.
Yeah, let's not forget that, you know, who knows how many hundreds and thousands are dying in the Mediterranean right now, you know, on rafts.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly, Stephen. Yeah.
So my prayer, and I don't pray because the closest I come to praying is what you heard earlier on, the space that Hank Jones playing those, that kind of music takes me to. That's my form of prayer, because I don't do churches. Sorry, no offense to people who do. It's just my own personal thing. I get there a different way, and my prayer is that people who don't have this compassion for their fellow man that they seem to be able to channel into greed, that they find the compassion and help this world be the kind of place that we would all like it to be. So we'll probably park it right there. And I just want to thank all of you for coming in and giving, you know, your thoughts on what's going on right about now, on top of the pandemic and on top of everything that's going on. And not to forget that I'm here in the company of six wonderful artists, five, because I just saw six pictures. I'm not gonna give myself, fuck it, I'm wonderful too, but excuse my French. that's the invisible man that I counted in there. Anyway, five wonderful artists and a guy who's hanging out outside a make-believe coffee shop. So, anyway, good night, everybody, and see you in the next go.
Thanks for having me.